Well, Scott, I wanted to ask you about the war itself, and whether you think that the pennant winners would have been any different in that period had they been not dealing with the war.
Yeah, I think it's a good possibility. You know, when you take Feller, Williams, DiMaggio, you know, Henrik, Dickey, and all the guys out of the game, yeah, that does make a difference. But yeah, I think it gave an opportunity for other teams to compete who normally wouldn't compete, like the Browns and some others that had a chance to do something different. Yeah, I it definitely changed the scale of the game with so many guys out, and each year you would have to try and replenish your roster with guys who normally you probably wouldn't consider, but you'd have to look at them and pitchers, you know, guys who had been out of the game or take a chance on others, and all around the board. I think it very difficult to field a consistent team as each year went by. So it did give, you know, it opened things up. You wouldn't see like the Yankees winning 110 every year, you know, from 42 to 46, or anybody else doing that, or Boston without Ted Williams and you know, Bobby Doerr was lost. I think in 44 they lost Bobby Doerr. Yeah, so I think it was. Would have been some different results had there not been a war, or if the players hadn't gotten involved.
And it was also that way in both leagues because the Cubs made it in 45 with no pitching, you know, I mean, and lost to the Tigers. So, I mean, it affected all teams. It's pretty amazing.
Were there any strategies that were particularly effective?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Were there any strategies that were particularly effective?
I think each manager was just like, you know, flying by the seat of their pants, trying to figure out what the combinations and what to do. You know, here in Cleveland, you know, we had guys coming and going. You know, we had like Paul O'Day playing for us for a while. You know, he couldn't see out of one eye, and some other guys that we brought in and out. So it was tough to feel like, again, a consistent team and use any real strategies. You know, Boudreaux always wanted to run and to hit and run and steal bases and do that. But, you know, when your talent is limited, there's not a lot you can do with his strategy. And if you don't have your home run hitters, you play long ball, it's kind of tough to follow through on that. I think each manager just kept experimenting as they were going along and trying to find a strength of their team and go with that. But it was a major struggle for these teams to be competitive. I know what somewhere in the mid 40, I don't know if it was 43 or 44. Albert Bradley made a silly comment about maybe they shouldn't play baseball this year, and everybody jumped all over him for that. And then he quickly retracted that. But that's kind of the environment that it was. A lot of uncertainty and. You know, you just didn't know what you had as a ball club until probably a month or two into the season. And then you weren't even sure then if, you know, guys might be leaving and or if anyone might be coming back. It was tough.
Did the fans accept that? I gather, maybe I'm wrong about this, is that they kind of just did it for the fun of it and weren't too concerned about not having the better players?
They just did the best they could. You know, the fans, I think, were very accepting. The fans did, I think in about 44 and 45, attendance started to go back up again. People were starting to come back to the ballpark more. But it was as what they wanted it to do. They wanted a diversion from the war. I mean, that was taking a heavy toll on everybody. People just working in the war industry, or, you know, you had your husband or your brother or your uncle overseas, you worried every day if you'd be getting a telegram or what would happen. And going to a ball game, which you could just put it all aside for a couple hours and, you know, have something to eat, have something to drink, cheer, yell, or whatever you wanted to do. And I think baseball served that purpose. But I think the players and the managers were trying to win, you know, as always. It's best. They knew their limitations, but they were trying to go out and put on a good show for everybody and play the best that they could.
You in the book, as you typically do, you have a wealth of subplots, incredibly interesting to me anyway, narratives over the underneath. And the one that is I was thinking about this morning is the Alva Bradley Bill Veeck interaction. And as I was reading it, I was thinking about, in some ways, it almost sounded like Dick Jacobs and Art Modell, how Dick Jacobs ran circles around Art Modell with regard to getting a new stadium versus replenishing or refurbishing the mistake on the lake. What was your perspective as you did the research about those two individuals?
I was surprised because before I did the research, I assumed that Bradley and Beck had met at least several times and talked about what was happening, but that didn't seem to be the case at all. That Beck completely went behind Bradley's back and just went to stockholders to buy out their stock to build up, you know, equity in the club. So that really surprised me that apparently Bradley really did not know for sure what was happening until the very end, when one of the Sherwin brothers told them just about 2 or 3 days before the actual sale what Beck had done. And Bradley was just caught completely in the dark. I guess he probably thought, and he never occurred to him in all the years that he owned the team to buy up more shares to get controlling interest in the team. I think he thought it would just go on like that forever. He could own his 25%, the other stockholders would have theirs, and he would run everything like always. But he had no idea about someone like Beck or what they were capable of, and he stayed in the dark. I was amazed that not one of the shareholders, I know a lot of them had passed away, but their widows or their sons or daughters, or their lawyer or banker who was handling these shares, never gave Bradley a heads up.
That fascinated me too.
Cannot believe, especially the Sherwins, because John Sherwin was a major factor in Bradley buying the ball club. Back in the 20s, Sherwin was one of the wealthiest guys in town, a banker, real estate guy, and he pledged to buy 20 to 25%. And with Bradley and his brother Chuck, they knew right then and there they had about 50, 51% there. They could find other shareholders. I'm not sure if Sherwin didn't go in with Bradley if he would have bought the club, but they were very good friends. They socialized a lot. Then Sherwin passed away, and apparently his sons and his wife didn't really want to stay with the club or continue, but you think they would owe that much to Bradley to say, a guy just came over named Bill Beck. He wants to buy all our shares of the ball club. I'm not sure if you know or not. They didn't tell him until just a couple days before, which I still can't believe that nobody had talked about that or mentioned that. That Beck really did, to me, was very, it was a hostile takeover. And Bradley was blindsided and was caught being too complacent. And he lost the ball club against his will. He made the offer at the end to buy everybody out, but it would take a few months, you know, to raise the money. I'm sure would have raised the money, but they would not go with him. They just said Beck made the offer first. So it was very cold, you know, after 20 some years of, I think, of all of the stockholders and families to just say, and, you know, they didn't make dividends every year, but they did get dividends. They did earn money from the team of more often than not. And to me, it's like, gee, you know, talk about loyalty or
lack thereof.
Lack thereof. Gee, you just let this guy hang out to dry. It was just terrible, I thought.
In your research about Bill Beck, obviously somewhat a bigger than life person in Cleveland sports, did you learn anything new that surprised you about him that, gee, I would have never thought that or whatever?
I think, maybe a little bit his competitiveness and to outdo other people. He was a showman and a great promoter, but it seemed to me he always wanted to outdo somebody. If somebody did something, he wanted to top it, you know, regardless of what was happening. I think he also had a very careless attitude with his shareholders, that he spent incredible sums of money, and I doubt whether he talked to the shareholders about it. Like in 48, when he bought like Sam Zoldak, like $100,000, and he spent like $60,000 on Johnny Berardino and others, he spent an absolute fortune. And I don't think he consulted anyone about it. He just said, well, I've got to have somebody, and I'll pay whatever it is. Like $100,000 for Sam Zoldak. And he pitched well. He was helpful. But I just cannot believe that someone would do something like that with technically other people's money. Maybe they did get their okay, but I'm not sure about that. You know, I was never able to find out that he was in concert with the shareholders. And then, of course, we know when he had to give up the team, he didn't have any money, really. All he had was his stock. So settled with his first wife. So he was a free spender, which I was not really surprised. But I think to outdo things, there's a little bit in there about with the Yankees, where they had a day where they, during the war, they gave nylon stockings to the first, I don't know, 5,000.
500 versus 503 or whatever. Yeah.
So he had to outdo that. I mean, why? I don't understand why he had to. Just doing it was a very nice gesture because, you know, things were the shortages and rationing. but did you have to just do that and say, ha, 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 I did more than you? It was kind of like, who's competing like that? And then later when he brought in carnations from Hawaii, from a flower plantation, flew them to Cleveland in a special plane. He spent a fortune on that. And again, the answer is, why couldn't you have gone to a florist in Northeast Ohio and got some kind of nice flower for half the money or less? Nobody would have complained about it. But he had, I think he, you know, he really craved attention. He wanted everyone to be looking at him to all the time. Sure, he wanted a great ball club, and but he had a, you know, tremendous ego, obviously, that he just always was always up front.
Thank you. That, yeah, that's fascinating.
You know, I'd like to jump in here. Scott, I really enjoyed the book, and I didn't hit any places in the book where I felt like I wanted to skip a few pages. That never happened. Wow. But one of the things that that I guess I didn't realize, and I knew what a great pitcher Bob Feller was, but I was not aware of what big crowds he drew when he pitched in other ballparks, when he and even on when he went and did the barnstorming, you know, and had his team and pitched against Satchel Paige and whatnot. I didn't realize he was that big a draw all over the country.
Oh, he was, yeah. He was the guy. People always wanted to see him pitch in any ballpark, and guaranteed Feller pitching, you're going to have a decent crowd. Everybody wanted to see the flamethrower, to see him pitch. So he was really a tremendous draw. You know, of course, Williams, DiMaggio, the Yankees were, but yeah. Bob was always from day one. I think maybe the fascination when, cause he started at 17 years old and was successful as a teenager. I think that people were astounded by that and just grew from that Bob Feller was a special player. He was way above the average pitcher. And if you went to see him pitch, you're going to see something that you wouldn't normally see, whether he won or whether he lost. He was always a threat. You know, he threw the no hitters. He always was a threat to do that again. I think people thought, went to see that, could he do it, or see what kind of, or he break another strikeout record. There was always something he could do. And I think people identified with him too. He was very, very, very withdrawn, but on the shy side to begin with. You know, when he was young, he was kind of aw shucks kind of kid. Very, you know, very, very humble. And I think people appreciated that. The later, you know, after the war, I think, you know, when he came back, he was something of a different guy, you know, much more aggressive and much more assertive. But I think he just, all those things attracted people and they wanted to see him. Plus, I know ladies liked him. He wasn't a ladies' man, but I've read several times that the women just really liked him. When he was on the mound, they just want to go there. Oh, look at Bob. He's so handsome. Mm-hmm. That was another thing. Women liked him. He was, you know, very gentlemanly and very chivalrous. He was, he had a lot of things that people liked.
Didn't he have almost some hero status, having been the first person to enlist after Pearl Harbor? I would imagine that helped his popularity to some extent.
Oh, sure. That he didn't wait, where most of everybody waited to get drafted. And a lot of the guys got to play all of 42. They just said, yeah, I'll go tomorrow when they call me. But they didn't get called till after the season ended. He didn't even consider that. He mm-hmm. just immediately went in the, even though he knew his father was ill too. You know, his dad was very sick. You know, he would die a short time later. But he still went, knowing that his mom and his sister, his sister Margaret, they would be needing him, but he still went and never gave it a second thought. He most likely, had he waited to be drafted, he could have pitched. I'm sure if he didn't make the whole 42 season, most of it, he would have had some, you know, even better numbers then with guys coming and going. So he was one of the very few that just didn't even blink. It was, I'm going, and I'm going as fast as I can. And mm-hmm. I'm not going to just be I'm not a recruiter. I'm not going to go pitch for 3 years around the country and recruit guys. I'm going to the South Pacific and I'm going to fight. And he did. And, you know, he was he was in a lot of battles. He had 8 battle stars. He was in a lot of battles and in harm's way quite a bit, but it never bothered him in the slightest. And even, you know, I heard Bob talk and was there when Bob talked. He never had a regret at all about it. That, yeah, he lost 3 years in his prime. He never thought, oh, gee, what records I could have set, or I got, you know, it was too bad. I didn't get to do that. Never was a concern for him.
Mm-hmm. I think it's fascinating.
He would have been well over 300 games if he didn't miss the war.
Oh, sure. No, oh, without a doubt. But strikeouts in 3 years, you know, Bob, probably about 600 to 700 strikeouts, probably more. Maybe another no-hitter. possibly too. The things he would have done would have been astounding had he been able to continue playing ball all those years. And what really too got was I was the kind of amazing individual he was. When he came home, he had very little time to try and pitch and get in shape. He came home in April of 45, and he pitched a little bit for the Great Lakes team. But he got his discharge in late August. He flew home to Cleveland that day, worked out at League Park, and pitched against Detroit the next day, and went 9 innings and gave up 2 runs. Very early, he gave up the 2 runs, and he just shut him down. And he won 5 games in just in the last month of the season. It's like, how do you possibly do that? Being away from the game, being an elite talent, not being able to compete for 3.5 years, and then go out there and not miss a beat. And then go on barnstorming tour and then come in the next season and have a spectacular season in 46. That's remarkable that it was like, it didn't matter. He could put down a baseball for 3 years and pick it up and be just as effective. I don't know how many guys could have done that.
Then when he would go barnstorming, at times he would pitch 5 innings 3 days in a row.
Yeah, he wasn't supposed to, I think. He's supposed to have a limit. He's supposed to go maybe 3 innings tops, but he was competitive. Yeah. Yeah. And he, I don't think he could help himself. But he also probably felt the crowd came out to see him, you know, and he's there in some local city or town and the stands are full. There are 8,000 people, and 2,000 people are standing. I think he felt an obligation that I can't just pitch 3 innings. I've got to do more. Mm-hmm. And I don't think anybody would have faulted him for, you know, for leaving after 3 and waving to everybody and walking off. But he was ultra competitive, even in, you know, just barnstorming to make money. But yeah. He was just a rare individual that played the game, that was just remarkable, everything he accomplished and all the things he did.
Yeah, he fascinated me the more I've read about him, the Bob Feller, the businessman, from the high school kid to the businessman, that transition. He seems to be a pretty complicated person, much more so than perhaps he was given credit for.
Yeah, oh he was. There's a quote in there from Alva Bradley after the war. It says, Bob's not the same guy. He's not the same guy he was before he left. He's a different man. And he was, when he came back, he had, I guess, maturity, just other things. And he was not the same guy. He immediately wanted to go barnstorming because he said it in the papers and everywhere that I probably lost $120,000. I want to make it up. He didn't just say, oh, well, you know, that's good. No, he wanted to earn as much as he possibly could. So he went on his barnstorming tour. He didn't take a break. He just really pitched for several months. And then he had a school. He had a camp for guys who've been in the armed forces, who are major or minor leagues. They could come there for 3 weeks and work out in Florida, and scouts would come to see him. He was there. Then he went right to training again. So he was like pitching. He didn't take a break for over a year. He made a lot of his money back, but he was, after that, he was, you know, a fierce barnstormer. People then started to get on his case about, it's all about money to Feller, you know, it's all about how much money he can make. That he got into it with the commissioner because he wanted to go to Latin America, and he didn't get permission, and he set up this whole tour and it was denied. There was headlines in the Sporting News and all the papers that he was feuding with the commissioner about it, that he just, you know, I'm doing this and too bad. Of course, he didn't wind up doing it, but he would go just about anywhere he could. Mexico, you know, anywhere he could pitch, he would do it. And people got on his case a bit about it, especially when he didn't get up to a good start in 48. People really started to roast him about, maybe if he didn't go barnstorming all the time, you might be a little more effective. He took some heat from people then. But that was all about business. He realized that, you know, he can only play for so long, and he wanted to make every extra dime that he could. And you saw him doing a lot of ads in the newspapers, you know, for shoes and for something else, for televisions and anything at all he could put his name on. He was doing that, Wheaties, everything. So he became quite a businessman when he came back from the war. I guess he looked at things, he didn't have that like wonder, I think, in his eyes about, gee, I'm a major league ball player. And it's like, this is a business and I want to make it, you know, people have taken advantage of me. I want to make as much money as I possibly can as long as I'm a ball player. And he continued to take every opportunity possible and do it.
How do you think he felt about Negro League players?
I think he looked at it as that they were ball players and they were good. And especially in barnstorming, was like, I can make money with these guys. So that was, I think, his main concern. And I think it bothered him in the slightest, really, who anybody was. He just wanted to draw the most people possible. And there's certain cities he knew there was a a good black population, yeah, he would want to play there because he knew they would come out to see Satchel and his all-stars as well as him. So I think his feelings were basically just for, he thought of himself first. Like, I don't really care if the guys are green, red, orange. We can make money on this tour. And at this particular venue, we can make a fortune. So it doesn't bother me a bit. So I don't think he was really fazed by it at all. I don't think that had any kind of concern for him as far as who was who. He just wanted to go out there and make a living. And it didn't matter who his teammates were. So I think when Dobie came, I don't think Feller even really batted an eye when Dobie came to the team and Page. I don't think it meant anything to Feller at all, except I hope he can help me win some games. I think that was really his main concern. So yeah, I think he was a little progressive in that sense, but I don't think he thought all that much about it. Just like, you know, I want good teammates who can play ball and we can win something. And that was or other guys might have been, yeah, I want to do that, but I don't want the African Americans on my team. I don't want to play with them. But Feller was just like, yeah, can they play? Good, then let's have them.
Yeah. Okay.
Scott, when Larry Doby came to the team, you know, there's talk over the years, why wasn't he sent out the way Jackie Robinson was sent out, and the pros and cons of seasoning and also getting acclimated to playing with white players and something like that. Cleveland had, I don't know exactly what the affiliation was, but the affiliation with Baltimore, Oklahoma City, Wilkes-Barre. Do you think there was any consideration of Dobie and especially since there was no position for Dobie with the Indians? You think there was any consideration of sending him down, say, to Oklahoma City?
I don't think so. Vec is one thing. Vec made a, you know, a monumental decision by signing Dobie, but he never thought about, well, what am I going to do with him? I think his responsibility, well, I'm going to get him, and then it's up to Boudreau to figure something out, which was terrible because we had an all-star infield and Larry was an infielder. It's like, how can you sign an infielder when there's nowhere to put him? You can't just say, okay, we'll make you our new center fielder. You've never played there. This is the middle of major leagues. You know, we're going to put you out. They couldn't do that. I think he put a big burden on Boudreau. Like, here, Lou, do something with him. And Lou was kind of thinking, what can I do? I'm not benching myself. I'm not benching Keltner. We just got Joe Gordon. I'm not benching him. Robinson's hopefully our power hitting first baseman. I don't know what to do with this guy. There's nowhere to put him. And we want to win games. I mean, I could put him in the outfield, but you know, he's going to be on the job training. He's going to screw up. So we don't really want to do that. So Vec didn't think it through at all. As far, he should have gave major advance warning to Boudreau and told him, this is what I'm thinking of doing. So Lou was kind of stuck with him. He couldn't put him anywhere. And I don't think there was any intent. I know the papers, I think it's Gordon Cobble that wrote about, you can't send Dobie to Oklahoma City because he would run into all kinds of trouble there. He wouldn't be accepted. And Baltimore, iffy, you know, Baltimore's a little iffy there, that always been. But, you know, Wilkes-Barre, so I'm like, damn, maybe, yeah, you could have found a place for him there or something. But that was poorly thought out as far as I felt bad, you know, for Dobie, not just he's breaking the color barrier and all the abuse, but like, there's no position for him. You know, where are you going to play him? You know, it's kind of like, no, you sign another major league infielder when you already have a good starting lineup. What are you going to do with them? And so I think that's on Vec, that he just did not think. He was real excited to break the color barrier, to be the guy out front. He wanted to do that. The best player available, he thought, and everyone told him, was Dobie, but he never thought, yeah, but he's a shortstop second baseman. We can't really use him. It might, you know, we have to do something else. Yeah, we should get him, send him somewhere we think he could survive and put him in the outfield right away. So what they had to do in spring training, they had to train him then to play the outfield. They had to have Speaker and Hank Greenberg work with him. And he learned quickly. He became, you know, an excellent outfielder, but I think Boudreau had that burden. And that's another case. Vec flew by the seat of his pants. You know, he didn't think in the long term, and he gave Dobie an additional problem where people come out to see him in 47. He might pinch hit, or he might pinch run. That's about all you would see. There's, again, and the only thing I thought, though, was strange was in September, Eddie Robinson sprained his ankle or broke his ankle, and he would be out for the last 2.5 weeks. And there's an opening at first base for the last 2 weeks of the season. We're not going to win the pennant. What do the Indians do? They put Les Fleming at first base. Experience, but not your guy at all. Why not put Dobie at first base for 2.5 weeks. We'll see what he could do and we'll see how he could handle the bat. And that one, when there was, I looked in every paper, see if anybody brought it up the question, and nobody said a word as far as I could see. Like, why didn't you put him in at first base and let him get 60, 70 at bats and see how he could hit the ball or give him a little bit of experience? And he sat on the bench, and when Les Fleming hit probably 230 or something like that, that made absolutely no sense at all. And if that was Boudreaux's complete call, why didn't Vec come and say, hey, why aren't you playing this guy? I brought him in here. I paid the money. This and that. We're not going to win the pennant. It's okay with me. Let him start at first base. Because he did start that one game in Chicago where they benched, you know, Eddie Robinson for one game. That is mystifying to me why they didn't do that. Give him some at-bats and give him experience on the team. But they didn't. The next year, they gave him every opportunity in 48. But for some reason in 47, I think it was kind of ordained. Yeah, he's here and all that, but he's not going to play. That was it.
Scott, I was fascinated by, you touched very briefly on the, in the 40s, the owners were started to getting maybe a little bit worried about the growing interest on the fans' part about football, professional football. I did not appreciate that there was concern as far back as then. That really, that was probably ignorance on my part, but that really caught me by surprise that yeah, there were owners that actually saw what was coming.
Yeah, they knew it was, they were coming. They thought the football is growing. It's going to get bigger and bigger, and we don't want to compete in September and October with football. So there was a big concern about that as far as renting the stadiums and letting the guys play there on Sundays in the fall. There was major concern about that, and others that they did not want them to have any chance at all to play in their stadium, where you might have, Sunday, if you're competitive, if you're in a pennant race, you want to have a Sunday home game in September, because you're going to fill the park. It's going to be amazing. And it just didn't, that was something owners foresaw, and they were very worried about, and rightfully so, as the NFL would get bigger and bigger.
I just didn't appreciate it when it was that early they started some feeling.
Yeah, they did. I know that Vec had negotiated with Mickey McBride about dates in September. I think Vec kind of gave in to him. I think he let him have a couple games in September at the stadium. But there was condition that if there was a World Series, everything's out the window. You can't come anywhere near the stadium if we're in the World Series. That happened in 48. I don't know if we played here on a Sunday or not, but still the Browns couldn't practice or do anything at the stadium while the World Series was going on. So yeah, they had a concern and that they were right about that.
Yeah. The other thing that fascinated me was your narrative about the beginnings of the union, a union. That was fascinating to me too. Did not appreciate that.
Yeah, that was something I vaguely heard about, but very little. And I was fascinated to learn about this. This really was the catalyst to actually, even though it didn't work, to get players organized. It did work in a way that the owners kind of co-opted some of the things to pacify the players and give them things like a pension that came out of that, and daily money in spring training came out of that, and a minimum salary. That the guy Robert Murphy, the attorney, he saw the way things should be, and he had made a lot of sense. He wasn't trying to revolutionize the game, but he made sense in his arguments about collective bargaining. That why can't a player have a representative to bargain with their contract? What is wrong with that? It's wrong for the owners and their people and just the player to be there to negotiate. Why can't a player have help? And of course, they didn't get that right away. But the idea, like there wasn't a lot of people that said, boy, is that stupid? You know, it was not a bad idea. He also said he wasn't trying to break the reserve clause. He didn't like it, but he wasn't trying to break it down. But he thought players were entitled to some certain rights, and he brought them forward. And obviously, he made a lot of sense because the owners got together and made that counter plan. And they did give players starting a pension and other things and minimum salary and things that pacified the players enough for a while. But it sort of paved the way to get them the rights that they have today. And I think they still call it Murphy money, that in spring training, the guys get paid per diem, whatever. I think they still call it Murphy money, that he was the guy that helped them get that. It was really too bad that the big test was in Pittsburgh to see if the players would go out on strike. They needed two-thirds of the team. And they did get over half the guys vote to go out on strike. but they needed the two-thirds majority and they didn't get it. And then the owner stepped in and waved, you know, waved some carrots at the players, and they kind of said, okay, yeah, we want a pension, so we won't do the union thing if you give us the pension and our minimum salary and money and spring training and a few other minor concessions. Like after a doubleheader at night, no day game the next day, or any after doubleheader, no day game the next day, minor thing. But he did, Murphy did make some strides, and he really opened a lot of eyes, I think. You know, it would take a while, but guys got serious. We had player reps then. You know, Mel Harder was the Cleveland player rep. He finally got players represented, though I don't know what voice they really had at the major league meetings, probably just token, but at least they were able to go and they were able to formulate ideas, and guys took it real seriously. You know, Allie Reynolds was very vocal with the Yankees. He was their player rep, and he was very vocal and tried very hard to do things for the ball players. But it started the road, and I didn't really know the impact that it had, which was more than a lot more than what I thought. And it was a very noble gesture. It was, the guy was well thought out by Murphy, and he wasn't, I don't think, looking to make a fortune off of it either. He had said that if there was a union, the committee would be made up entirely of ball players. The officers would be ex-ball players and ball players. He wasn't trying to say, I'm going to be the director for $500,000 a year. He was really trying to help the guys out, and not enough of them appreciated that. I was amazed because some guys were very vocal against it, like almost to violence, like Bertie Tebbets and a couple other guys, a pitcher from the Cubs, were like ready to fight people about a union. Like, we've got it made here. We don't want a union. Like, really? Are you, you know, what kind of thinking is that? But that was the tone then in the 40s. But yeah, well, I thought it was a fascinating part of the game.
How did Mel Harder come to get the role that he got? How did that play out?
Player rep?
Yeah.
Well, Mel was the most respected guy on the team. He was the guy in 1940 that was chosen to talk to Albert Bradley about the players getting bit fired. Everybody went to the meeting, but it was Harder who did the talking, because Alva Bradley respected him and listened. If Jeff Heath would have done the talking, or Hal Trosky over the phone, because his mom had died, I don't think Bradley would have listened. But Mel Harder was somebody who thought, if Mel Harder is saying this, there's got to be something to it. So he was very well respected. When the players voted for someone to represent them, I think it was probably unanimous that the smartest guy here and the best guy is Mel Harder. He's a guy that he can handle things. Let's have Mel be our player rep. And rather than, you know, they didn't have anybody else, and it wasn't Keltner, you know, it wasn't Gordon, it wasn't Jim Hegan. No, it was definitely Mel Harder, and he was on the downside of his career too. It wasn't like he was going to be around for another 10 years or at all, but they wanted Harder as their guy to represent. And I think he had a voice in things, and probably was respected around the league at the meetings. At least they probably listened to what he had to say rather than just like shake their heads and frown. I think they listened to him. He was, I think, made for that. He was an even-tempered guy. He was a good guy. Didn't seem to have any kind of bad bone in his body. He was like the right guy to represent and do what he could for the players. So I think he was a wise choice for that. Yeah,
for sure. Thank you.
There were a couple of clues that perhaps baseball wasn't as big a deal as we thought. You know, there was no radio for a couple of years, and attendance really was not anywhere near what modern standards would be like. Did you find anything like that? Do you have the idea that maybe baseball was not as important to society as we've allowed ourselves to believe here in these advanced years?
No, I think it was. I think it was important. The attendance, you know, you can relate that to the war. And, but it was, you know, the attendance rose steadily after 45 to 46. I think people still lived and breathed baseball. I mean, the war kind of sapped everybody's strength and people's ability maybe to buy tickets. I think money had to be spent elsewhere with rationing. And so it maybe fell a bit, but it still was, you know, America's pastime. The newspaper accounts and everything were just plastered everywhere. Yeah, losing radio, that was kind of, that was a little unexpected. I don't think Albert Bradley, when the radio went down, I don't think he made a huge effort to try and reinstate it. He just kind of went with the flow there. Well, you know, there's all kinds of war news and other things. We can't quite work it out, so we won't have radio. So he kind of, I guess, wasn't too upset about it or concerned that they weren't doing the games on radio. Like maybe thought, well, then good, more people come back to the park. So I think, yeah, the interest was still there, but circumstances, the popularity ebbed and flowed a bit. But I think post-war, it really, it came way back again. You know, with Vec here, people went crazy, you know, with our 2 million in attendance in 48 and 47, we had way over a million, 49. The interest was extremely high when Vec really raised the barometer when he came back here. He pushed real hard to get radio going again as soon as he bought the ball club, and he wound up having AM and FM.
You know? Yeah, that was fascinating too.
That we actually, if you could get an FM receiver, if you would pay for it, you could get the Indians game on there or on AM. And he had certain things like, somebody broadcast Municipal Stadium, somebody else would broadcast from here. So radio was in full bloom. We had like three or four choices when Vec was here and got it back on the air. But in all, I think baseball did, the popularity did ebb and flow, but I think it was the times, what was happening then. And once everything was out of the way and prosperity was back, it was look out, here's baseball. And I think the crowds were more than satisfactory, and money, lots of money was to be made then. And the World Series games were, you know, extremely popular, and everything, even though when television first came along, and the 48 series, you know, Beck set up a mini network in the Midwest. There was interest in Illinois and Michigan and other states to see the 48 World Series there. So he set up this little network, and they beamed it from Cleveland, and people watched from different states. So there was definite, and maybe TV might have helped too. People like, well, I'm not going to the game. I don't want to sit in the bar with a radio, but here I am in my living room, I can watch it. And that probably spiked more popularity too. That was probably sorely needed, to have them on television, and people staying home or people who were ill or too old to get out could watch the ball game. And I think that spiked popularity too. So yeah, your question. Yeah, maybe yes, maybe no, but I think it's still what was the game. No question. Football was rising, but the number one story was baseball, I think still was.
Before the war, there was America First, with Republicans, including Robert Taft, resisting arming up. Was there a significant anti-war faction within baseball? Were some of the players thinking, I really don't want to serve?
Well, I don't think they were vocal about it, but yeah, it was obvious some players didn't want to serve. A lot of guys just waited for the draft and hoped for the best. They just sat on the sidelines. Some guys got very lucky. Ken Keltner didn't get called till like 44, I think. And he had said a couple times that I'm ready to serve whenever they call me. You know, he didn't enlist. Most guys didn't enlist. They waited. And then, you know, if you had kids and a wife, you could try and get a deferment, which a lot of guys did. It didn't go at all. You know, like Jeff Heath didn't have to serve. Guys just went to war jobs in the off season and they weren't called. They did that part of it and they got around things. Joining the reserves, and guys joining the Coast Guard, you were active in the Coast Guard, but the likelihood of you going overseas was almost nil. So you could do that. And so I think there was a lot of guys who did not want to serve. They wouldn't say it out loud, but they did everything they could to avoid going. This is common. It was the same thing in World War I, until the worker fight order in 18, that summer. Guys just were avoiding going right and left. They just waiting it out and trying to, then most of the guys went to war jobs. And you had your choice to go in the Army or work at a plant. Most of the guys worked at a plant and played on the baseball team there. A lot of the guys did that. They didn't go. So I think the same sentiment was World War II. A lot of them did not want to fight, and they waited it out. So their enlistment was, or their term was shorter. And if they had a family, they would apply, you know, for status, for deferment. I think that was very popular to do. And I don't think the fans were mixed. Some of the fans got on their case, and there were sometimes editorials in the paper about these guys are young and healthy, they should be overseas serving. There was even a little controversy about Boudreaux and his ankles, that he was 4F originally because of his ankles. He had broken his ankle in high school, and he broke it with the Indians. Then he was reclassified 1A. And he went back to the board, and the doctor then changed him back to 4F. And there's a little talk about that. That the explanation given was he has the bad ankles; it would be impossible for him to march for 8-10 miles a day like other soldiers do. The thing is, why couldn't they have given him an administrative job then? Why couldn't Lou been drafted, but he would have been at a desk somewhere? He could have been in France or Italy behind a desk doing things. He didn't have to be marching with the guys, but he was kept out of the Army completely. And there were some people that kind of said, why isn't he in some capacity in the Army? And others, Ted Williams had that fight too about it, where he played all of 42. He had that deferment because he was sole supporter of his mom. But when it was changed, he hired attorneys. And they had a big court case about it, whether or not he would go in or not. So there were a lot of them that's picking on Ted. I'm just saying that I think there were a lot of guys that did not want to serve and were really not so much against the war, but they didn't want to serve. And I think it goes to civilians too, guys who got drafted. They enlist, a lot of people, but I'm not going to enlist. I'll wait. When they get me, they get me. Or if, when they do, I'm going to apply for deferment because I have two kids. So there was some pushback, but I don't think it was overt where you didn't have much a guy saying, I'm not going to fight. I don't care what I can't remember any ballplayer saying that. They may have thought it, but very few, I think, would have the nerve enough to go out in public and say, I'm against the war and I don't want to fight. And I think it's wrong. We should stay home here and worry about ourselves. I think so. I think there was some sentiment, but everyone tried to stay patriotic as much as they could, because it would not have been appreciated when your husband's overseas and you're playing baseball making $10,000-$12,000 a year. That's, some people were resentful of that.
What would you classify the level of the play at that time? Double A, Triple A? How bad was it?
I would say mixed between Double A and Triple A. For a lot of the guys, we're not major leaguers, and everybody knew they weren't major leaguers. They were here to fill up a space. So, he had a guy like Orris Hockett, who was here. He did hit about 290 one year, but he was 29 years old. And he was a bit of, I'm not sure what his issues were, but he seemed to always want out for some reason or another. Pat Seary, I don't know if Pat would have got a chance in the majors had there not been a war. He's a tremendous home run hitter, but he was a strikeout king. He just flailed at the ball all the time, and they tried for years to fix him. I mentioned Paul O'Day. He had no vision in one of his eyes, but yet he was playing regular. And other guys they brought in and out. So I think the quality was somewhere between that. There were, sure, legitimate major leaguers out there, stars, still playing. Keltner played, for several years. Jeff Heath here in Cleveland, a number of other guys. But I think generally the caliber of play was suffered with, especially in the pitching. You just didn't have you couldn't get a strong four-man rotation. That was next to impossible. So you would bring guys in and out and hope for the best. The play was suffered a bit. Some of the catchers Cleveland had during the war, they would go back and forth with different guys. A local guy named Hank Ruskowski, I think would pronounce his last name. He caught for us for a while and was obviously wasn't major league material, but they didn't have an alternative. And some of the other guys that came in, they just had to hold down the position until the guys could come back. But I think everybody understood that the level of play was not where it should have been. And that's when Boudreaux won his only batting championship in 44. That had there been the full level of talent, would he have won a batting title? Maybe, probably not. Probably somebody would have beat him. I mean, he was fighting with Bobby Dorr the whole way, and then Dorr went into the Army. And he was gone. His average finish or whatever it was, 324. So Lua just had to stay one point above that to win the batting title. He did. But then, not demeaning Lou at all, but I don't think he would have won that. And some guys who became – Orris Hockett was an all-star one year. I don't think he would have been an all-star even on the squad if they had everybody there. But, yeah, I think it was not quite the caliber you would like to see. But, guys were out there giving 100%. So what could you expect?
The minors really took a hit at that time too, didn't they?
Yeah, a number of minor leagues had to shut down because their guys were 18 to 20, 21 years old, a lot of single guys. They would get drafted right away. There was no deferments for those guys. So they were just going in droves, hundreds at a time, and the minor leagues just couldn't sustain. So many of them shut down. And plus, whatever talent they had was stepped up by the major league teams. You had a guy who would look decent, he'd be in a major league lineup. So they were like, either everybody's going overseas or to the American and National League. It was very hard to keep going. So a number of them had to just shut down for lack of talent and lack of ball players and attendance too, with attendance going down quite a bit.
I wonder how many of those guys made the Hall of Fame because of, they're playing inferior competition. Like, I think Lou Boudreaux might be one who kind of benefited from that.
Sure, Lou benefited. Other guys, yeah, no question about that. Guys who were decent major leaguers. There, I'm sure if you took a look, you'd see their batting averages rise and stats, more home runs, and other things. Yeah, that may have helped them along the way. Guys who pitched during World War II were able to avoid going in the Army, put up some really good numbers they might not have put up otherwise. So it was probably, I didn't go look individually, but yeah, for Lou's case, I'm sure it helped him. It was a bit easier to hit when guys that you normally get you out were overseas or in the Army somewhere, the Navy or Coast Guard. Yeah, it was helpful to him and probably some other guys. If you looked at their comparison in stats, you know, what they did during the war and before the war and after, you'd see a big difference. But yeah, I'm sure it helped with the diluted talent. It's kind of like, you know, you play exhibition games against a AAA club. Yeah, usually the major leaguers go 3 for 4, you know, and have a home run and a double because the competition wasn't, the level wasn't that great. And it was, you could take advantage during that time, during the war.
Scott, you painted a really interesting picture of Alva Bradley as this transition of ownership, sitting in his seat behind the Indians dugout, stoically looking at the field while Bill Vack was working the crowd. I found that fascinating. But did Alva Bradley then just disappear from the sports scene, so to speak, once the sale was finalized?
Pretty much. I believe he kept his season's tickets because he was at the 48 World Series. I made a note that he was there out in the crowd. But yeah, he completely dropped out. And his brother Chuck had died, his partner. And I think he just devoted himself. I think he was just totally shocked by it and shaken by the whole thing. And, you know, all he wanted to do was run the Cleveland Ball Club. That was his thing. He wasn't preparing to step down or transition. And I thought it was interesting that they were building up a ball club even before Beck came through. You know, back in the minors now, we had Al Rosen, one of our top prospects in 46. Mike Garcia was pitching very well in the minors. We had Dale Mitchell was back. Now at Oklahoma City or playing wherever he was, you had some real talent there ready to come up. Not that would have pushed him to the World Series, but you did have some guys, and it wasn't like he forgot about everything. Him and Roger Beckenbaugh. No, they were, I think, in building. And I always look at the trade that Joe Gordon for Allie Reynolds. Now Gordon had a tremendous 48, no question. He was outstanding, but Reynolds was a good pitcher, and I kind of wonder if you had kept the pitching staff of Reynolds, Lemon and Feller, and Peck had got some other second baseman, not as good as Gordon, but a decent second baseman. Might they have won it in 48? Of course, yeah, we wouldn't have had Bearden, wouldn't have had Dobie probably, because Bradley was that old school. He wasn't going to rock the boat. But, you know, they might have had Garcia pitching in 48. They might have found a spot for Rosen then. It would have been interesting to see what kind of ball club. I got to think, if they didn't win it, they would have been a second or third place team at worst and building. Because attendance was going up, there was more money. So I always kind of wonder if Bradley might have finally pulled it off if Beck hadn't taken the team from him. But again, I can't recall. I don't know another incident you guys know of that happening to somebody who was owning a major league team, not a majority, but running the club for 20 years and then being forced out. And then you're completely out of the game, like overnight. You know, that just was just unbelievable how that could happen to the guy. And I don't think it ruined his life, but I think it really marked him for the rest of his days, that how that happened. He didn't get to gracefully retire or sell the team when he wanted to with the shareholders. He didn't get that opportunity. He was just out in the street. And I think people forgot that Bradley, you know, he held the team for 20 years, good, bad, or indifferent. You know, he fielded a team. I think he tried the best he could within his limitations. I read somewhere, I said he was one of the cheapest owners in baseball, but I didn't see that. He wasn't a free spender, but he paid Feller whatever Feller needed. There was never a problem contract with Feller, you know, in 40, 41, his best, when he was like dominating the league. Now, whatever the salary needed to be, that was okay. And Bradley was okay with hiring Lou Boudreau to be player manager. At first, he wasn't, but his shareholders, one of the guys, George Martin, talked about a young guy, and Bradley was won over. And he really liked Lou quite a bit to give a 24-year-old a shot. And then when Vet came in, one of the first things he talked about was firing Boudreau. Then there was a big uproar with the fans and all that. But, you know, Bradley had his pluses and minuses, but I think it was a shame what happened to him. He didn't get to leave the game with any dignity. And as far as he was a very well thought of owner. He was on a lot of committees in Major League Baseball. At the Major League meetings, he was a voice there. He was very well established in baseball, and to be like unceremoniously dumped like that, I thought it was a travesty. But it should not have happened that way. It should have been, Beck should have had some class and made work something out to make a graceful exit, something or other. But, you know, Bradley was, he was out of baseball just like that and done.
There was no role for him anywhere in baseball after he got dumped then.
No, I don't know if any other owners might have talked to him privately about something and he just said no. It's hard to think that everybody's going to turn their back on him and just never spoke to him.
Given the way you've characterized him.
Yeah, with Connie, he knew Mac. He knew Connie Mac very, very well. Clark Griffith, the New Yorker. And he was very intimate with all the owners. They all knew each other extremely well. And Will Harridge, the Yale president at the time, he knew Landis, you know, before Landis passed. You know, all these people had favorable opinions of him. It's hard to think that someone didn't reach out and say, I know, but maybe if you want to buy part of my team, you know, we could work something out, or we could. Maybe they had. Bradley just decided, no, I've had enough. This is time. You know, I'm done. He wasn't a young man per se. He was, I think, in his early. He was about pushing 60 in his early 60s, which then was, you know, you're getting up there in years. And I think he had some health issues, not major, but he was starting to get some health issues. But yeah, I would hope some people reached out to him, and he declined to go forward. It would have been really sad if he was just persona non grata from next day in 46 when Beck took over the team. Nobody spoke to him ever again. That would be hard to think.
So one thing next? I found kind of interesting was Jeff Heath comes off as like a little bit of an asshole in the book. Whereas when we read the Mrs. Morehart and the Boys book recently, a couple months ago. And in that book, she paints him in a pretty good light. And it's just interesting, the contrast there.
Good point.
Yeah, I think he was two different people, Jeff. He could be a nice guy, but he could be the worst guy on the team. It depended on what was going on. Probably off the field, he was probably a regular guy, but he caused every manager he had major, major problems. His antics over the years, you know, threatening Oscar Witt with a bat, and the fighting in the dugout with Johnny Broca, going in the stands and punching a fan. Doesn't get much worse than that. And his constant holdouts, especially when Lou is a new manager, you're really short on personnel during the war, and he's holding out every single year and causing problems and going public in the paper. So he definitely had a bad side. I haven't read the book about Mrs. Morehart about that picture, but no, he was. I know he was friendly with Feller. The two of them got along well, and he barnstormed with Feller for at least a couple of years. He would do that, he was popular enough to get an announcing job with the Seattle Pilots. He did that for a number of years, but he had a lot of things. Overall, as a teammate, I don't think that's the kind of guy you'd want to have it as a teammate. A guy who you wouldn't see him till probably mid-April. He'd be fighting to get in shape. He wouldn't be there at spring training. You never know if he was going to sound off against the manager, or he wasn't going to run out of ground ball, or if he was going to quit on a pop-up and let it bounce. Where some people said he knew he couldn't make the catch, so he would do that. Others said he just was a loafer. You know, people, they used to get on him. Gordon Cobblevic used to get on him a lot. He did not like him. And he said, you know, some nasty things in his column about Heath. So I kind of look at it. Yeah, he was not the best teammate. He did cause all kinds of headaches. So he was not, you know, the best guy around. He was a good player. He could play. It's a shame that he did not turn things around, you know, that he could have been on that 48 team. And enjoyed playing at the stadium when they moved in the fences, because he was always yelling about that I hit 410 foot flyouts where other guys have home runs, mine are caught. You know, I probably lost, I don't know how many home runs at that stadium. He hated the fences, no fences being there. That he'd slam ball at dead center field, 425, 430, he'll be an out. He hated it, so that he didn't get a chance to come back there when they moved the fences in. Then it would have been, okay, Jeff, now put up or shut up. You know, now the fences are 375 and 380. Let's see you hit a bunch. Let's see you hit 35 home runs here. He never got the chance to do it, and he didn't. And then, of course, he broke his leg in 48 before the World Series, where he didn't get a chance to at least play three games at the stadium and see him poke. That would have been hilarious if he would have been playing and slammed a three-run homer like 420 feet. That would, I'm sure, look on his face and on the faces would have been something to see, you know, the prodigal son coming home. But it didn't happen. I guess kind of the long answer, but I looked at Heath all the way from the beginning, you know, from his first day in the team to his last day. I think overall he caused a lot of trouble, could not be a good teammate, and maybe he wasn't that bad of a guy off the field, but I didn't see what she did when she wrote. I didn't see the same things.
So, Scott, what's next for you in the Scott Longert Indians Beyond trilogy?
I don't know. I'm still debating if I should continue, because a lot has been written about the 50s and the team and the guys on the team. 54 has been written about quite a bit of things. I know there's been books on Luke Easter, and Joe just did that book on Al Rosen, which is really excellent, by the way. I had fun reading that. So I don't know if that's a viable area. I've been looking into Ray Chapman, looking because there's so much more has come to light over the years. You know, Mike Sowell's book was outstanding, but that was written up in the late 80s. You know, since then with the internet and all, there's a lot more details about Chapman's life that have come forward. So I've been thinking about maybe just trying to look at that. And post Chapman, where, you know, not a lot is written, is his relationship with his wife, with Katie, and her committing suicide. There was quite a lot of circumstance with that as well. So I don't think his story ended in August of 1920. There was more to it. And that's what I've kind of looked at, that the beautiful new house that was built for them by Mr. Daly in on Alveson Drive, which they never lived in. They never set foot in the house when it was finished. It was sold right after, you know, about 2 months after he died. I mean, that was real. The house is still there, but the Chapmans never lived in it. That Katie remarried in 1923, but she married her first cousin, her mom's nephew, which is very unusual. They had to get permission from the Catholic Church to do it. She moved to California, to Los Angeles. It seemed very odd to leave her entire family behind, to go away alone to Los Angeles. And then she didn't flourish there. She would eventually kill herself in LA. It just, you know, a really sad legacy. And then Ray, their daughter would die the next year of meningitis. But that's the only I looked at that. I got a copy of a death certificate. I wasn't looking for it, but somehow was connected to real estate transactions about the Chapmans and Daly's. Her death certificate is there. She died of meningitis. There was it's all to say that she got there was a measles epidemic and she caught the measles, but that didn't seem to be the case. And somehow she got bacterial meningitis and died from that at 9 years old. So I think there's a lot more to his story that's been told. So I'm thinking about it, but I don't know if, because again, a lot of people know a lot his story. People would be interested in reading more about him. I don't know. But just a bit of tossing that around.
When's the decision time come for you?
Oh, I don't know. Probably a few months. I've been looking at things. I was able to get in touch with the Heron Illinois Libraries, Historical Society, and they gave me a few things. I also found that he went on a barnstorming tour in 1914. Frank Bancroft was running it, and they worked their way out to California. But the decision made was to go to Hawaii. They went to Honolulu for 2.5 weeks. I think it was the first ball players there since 1888, and it was wildly successful. He was the shortstop on the tour. So I'm reading a little bit about the tour, that the guys all made some money and they got to spend 2.5 weeks in Hawaii. A lot of guys brought their wives with them. And it was, you know, the American League All-Stars were there, and the National League All-Stars. It was pretty competitive. And so that's kind of an interesting thing that he was able to do. And his courtship of his wife, she was just a major society person, that she was in the newspapers constantly for all the things she was doing. So there's things I'm still looking to try and compile things and make a decision if that's something I should try and pursue. I don't know. You know, now War on the Diamond, the documentary, I don't know if you guys probably saw that, or a chance to see that. Apparently that's going to be on the screen in July, from what I understand. It's going to be, the DVD is going to be released. It's going to be available on video on demand. And I think some other places as well, they were talking about. So that's going to surface in the summer. So I don't know if I would be getting in their way or anything like that. I don't know. So
or enhancing the story.
Or maybe, yeah, maybe. Yeah. So I'm just kind of testing the waters and seeing how it goes.
I thoroughly enjoyed this book. I really did.
Thank you. I enjoyed writing it. It was great. It was great fun to do this one.
Different than the others? I mean, to me, it was like, wow, it's time for the next chapter of the Scott trilogy or Beyond trilogy. But was there something different about this book?
Well, I think the war years, I thought it was fascinating how baseball fought to survive, how the country got together, you know, in this war effort, to get behind it and to get through it, and all the courage that the soldiers had and all the people involved and all the courageous things, and how the country somehow tried to be somewhat normal, even though it was next to impossible to be. But, you know, on a Sunday afternoon, having 20,000 at a baseball game yelling at the umpire when, you know, there's a huge battle overseas, or D-Day is just taking place, and it's tremendous attack. The turn point of the war, the turning point happened there in 44 in France. And you know, we're home talking about baseball and things that happened before, you know, the Judge Landis passing away. before the start of the 45 season, you know, abruptly dying, and then they weren't prepared for a commissioner. So these things really were fun to look at it and see all the and see the things that they were up to and what they were trying to do. So I think more so than the other books, this had a lot of elements to it that I'm real interested in getting into.
Well,
Scott, I appreciate your stopping by.
Oh, my pleasure.
I think our time has elapsed. We've got to get off the Zoom here. But I hope you'll return and keep joining us for,
sure.
for the book. And,
be happy to. Hope
we helped you sell a few.
Yeah. Yeah, we know. Yeah, but we're doing okay. It's going all right.
Yeah. I was glad you did the Ohio University Press. You don't hear much from them sometimes.
I've been fortunate. I was there at the right time years ago, and they wanted to get into sports. They were looking for a baseball writer or a football writer, and I just happened to be at the right place at the right time and talked to one of their editors. That's how we started the relationship. It's been a good one.
Well, I found it cool that you have an agent, and so out there working for you. When I got a call from him saying, "Hey, would you be interested in having Scott be part of a future meeting?" And I said, "I've already talked to him, but you're his agent? Really? Wow, this is cool stuff here we're talking about."
Yeah, he's great, but he works for all the authors.
Yes, you know? But he's a really nice
person to talk with. He's not my personal guy. I wish I had him, but I don't.
Be cool, though. You got at least a part-time agent. That's
part-time.
All right.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate it all.
Yeah, and, Scott, it was great. Thank you so much on the Saturday morning.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate the time.
Good job.
Bye-bye. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.